So lastly, we talk about standard template library. It's a set of common classes and functions. It's very powerful in C++ and one of the reasons why we have this 1000 plus pages in the standard. So it's typically shipped with the compiler and part of the C++ core library. It has a lot and a huge number of templates for many functionality. So what functionalities do we have? We have four major components that we can use. We have containers that are like abstract data types or data structures. We have iterators, which we will talk about a little bit. That they are means to iterate over elements in containers, for example. And we have algorithms, of course, typical standard algorithms. And lastly, some functions that support us a little bit. The RP is huge and it must be studied to understand. As all of those components internally that you may use come with various methods and semantics. Typically, they have a core structure, so some idea how the semantics works for containers, for iterators, for algorithms and functions, and all the different implementations of algorithms, functions, and so on follow this kind of core principles. So it's a really good idea to understand these principles. And let's get started by looking at a specific container, which is the vector. So what is vector? Well, it's basically a dynamically allocated array that allows you to address values at positions directly. So let's have a look how we use it. First, we have to include this type, which is vector. And as it's part of the standard library, you don't have to use .hpp or anything. And we use the namespace std because vector is in standard. Now let's create a vector of integers. And as it is a template, well, we have to specify the type here. This vector is called now IA. So IA is my variable name and identifier for it. And what I can do, I create here a for loop and I use the method pushback to basically add at the end of the vector this element I. I is of type integer, so this can be added at the end of this vector. Then I call here, I try to find out the size of the vector, which is a typical function or method for containers. And then I want to access element number 6, so I can use here the brackets over here to access the box brackets to access element number 6 directly. Yeah, that is what it means. I can access values at positions directly, and that's what the semantics of a vector is. You find much more information here on this link. Note that the web page c++.com is really powerful, really useful, and you find for all of the standard library detailed explanation. I prefer this much more over a book. Okay, let's have a look at the second container, which is map. This is an associative container for tuples, so you can put in keys, value pairs, right? So I can put in a certain value for a specific key, and they are somehow ordered and sorted inside. So what I can do, for example, is I can create a map from integers to strings. So first I need to include our map type, then I create a map. This now takes two template arguments, an integer to a string, and now on the map for the integer 10, I want to store the string value at position 10. For the position 20, I store value at position 20. So note that this is now really as more a sparse type. So it's not like vector, which has filled all the intermediate values. So here exists the value 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, for example. Here, in this map only exists 10 and 20 as element because these are the only elements that I stored inside. Now I can try to output value at position 6. It will output the empty string because it's not part of our map. And I can also retrieve the string back that I stored in position 21 using m20. Yeah, there are many more that we could talk about. Lists are of course there. Stacks, queues, there are so-called priority queues, which are represent our heap properties. Min, max heaps, basically. We can have sets, which differ that we have a list where only one element of each value can be stored inside. Here, a map, an unordered set, and so forth. So many more in there.